Hey, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Mission Sunday. Normally, we would have our announcement video just play right after the prelude, but since a lot of our service today includes video from our missionaries and our outreach partners and everything like that, we figured we'd do live announcements for once. Plus, I'll give you the reminder as to why we kind of like to do our announcements first. Even though there's always a lot of stuff going on and people might still miss some of the details because you might be having your own conversation still before church really gets rolling. We really want to try to get a lot of the quote-unquote business stuff out of the way before we get to the really important thing for Sunday, which is worshiping the Lord, glorifying Him, and being, as a congregation, doing that together. So let's go ahead and get those short announcements. It's not going to be too much going on because, as always, we say it every single week in the video, you guys can look at the e-bulletin, which I'm going to consult for the specific details of the announcements that I have to give you guys this morning. As a reminder, this is Mission Sunday. If you weren't here last year, this is something that we do or try to do starting last year, every year, in a way to kind of keep us connected and plugged in with all of the information and goings on with our missionaries who are not only overseas, but also the local ministries that we support here as a church. We're also going to highlight some of the specific ministries that are run within Exeter BFC. You'll get to hear about those after we hear about our local partners as well as our missionaries, but the important thing to remember is that it's a family Sunday, which means the kiddos are in here, and there is no workers this morning in the nursery. If you need to use the nursery with your nursery-age kid, feel free to go on in there, and the room is unlocked, the lights are on, the toys are ready to be played with, but otherwise, this is just a Sunday for us to gather as one big family and learn about what the Lord is doing, not just internationally, but here locally as well. The other reminder is that it's the end of the month, which means pastor appreciation timing is ending. So if you wanted to help donate a little bit towards the trip that we're sending the Burtons on in November, you can still do that. The link for that is in the e-bulletin, or you can make a note on your offering envelope specifically for pastor appreciation. And then there's another thing which you'll learn about today. It's been in the e-bulletin for 2 weeks now, but we're starting a new ministry called ESL, which is English as a Second Language. It's an outreach ministry we'll host here at the church. There's going to be some more information about that coming. Like I said, you'll get a quick introduction to it in one of our videos, but there's an informational meeting following the service next Sunday. And there's not any major requirements to be involved in this ministry except for the fact that you're able to show up and maybe be faithful with whatever responsibility you are given. Some of it might be conversational. Some of it could be as simple as helping with things like setup or cleanup or hosting a party or something like that when it comes time to do that. So you can get some specific information in the e-bulletin, or you can come to that meeting, which is really what I would love for everybody to do, our meeting after the church next Sunday's service. So November 3rd, after church, stake around in the sanctuary, and you can get some more information about ESL. There's plenty more. Please check out the e-bulletin, but that's really all we wanted to focus on this morning. We're still going to do our normal meet and greet, so you guys go ahead and stand if you're able. Greet your neighbor around you. We'll get started with worship in just a moment. As everyone makes their way back to their seat, we'll start with a song this morning. And as just a reminder, there's going to be some videos interspersed before we get to our main speaker this morning. So absolutely, if there's ever any time during the service where you need to get up and use the bathroom or anything like that, we're not going to be doing quite as many long stretches of standing when it comes to our worship songs. We'll just do one song kind of at a time before we move on to our next thing. So even though this service feels a little bit different than what our normal, what you might even say liturgical week-to-week service looks like, it's still going to be a great service for us to be able to learn all that the Lord is doing and glorifying Him right now. So we'll sing some familiar songs. We'll get some old information, some new information, and hopefully through it all, the Lord can continue to grow us through whatever He has for us this morning. I'm going to read a quick scripture verse for our first song this morning in Romans chapter 8, verses 38 through 39. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. We're going to start things off with "Your Love Never Fails." And as we'll hear, it's not just here in this place, but all around the world, we know that our God is faithful and that He does all He can for those who are called according to His purpose, but ultimately it's all for His glory. So let's sing together this morning. Verse, nothing can separate. Nothing can separate. Even if I ran away, Your love never fails. I know I still make mistakes. You have new mercies for me. Every day, Your love never fails. It never fails. In the chorus, You stay the same.
Joy comes in the morning.
To our first video this morning. You guys can have a seat. And I just wanted to give a tiny little reminder here. As you can kind of tell as the video goes on, this is one video of all of our missions, missionaries, updates from them, as well as our local missions partners here in the local area. And as the video kind of goes further and further along, you can tell the production value kind of increases a little bit as these people who are doing the missions, especially international, there may not be a lot of opportunity for technology or even things like internet. Just something that I wanted to kind of point out is even one of our missionaries, we didn't get a video from her specifically, from Vicky Martin, but we did get a letter that I was able to read for the video as well. So I hope that you enjoy this time right now. This is going to be about a 20-minute video in total. And feel free to clap. There's going to be blackouts between each of the videos and the transition. So you can interact with this a little bit if you feel like that might be a good idea. Also feel free if there's any need to get up or anything like that. Go ahead and take that time to do that without any judgment. But let's go ahead and get some updates from our mission partners.
We're Alan and Deanna Heathcote, serving with Biblical Ministries Worldwide.
We are both members of Exeter. I have been a part of the church since birth. My parents were Leroy and Mary Spatz. Alan was born in Zimbabwe, and we met at Bible College in the U.S. We were married at Exeter and were later sent out as missionaries by the church. We serve in South Africa and Zimbabwe in Southern Africa.
We're involved in leadership training for church planting in two locations, one in South Africa, one in Zimbabwe. In South Africa, we're helping in a South African-led church plant, Kanana Baptist Church in the township of Tembisa, northeast of Johannesburg. I serve as an elder there, assistant pastor, Bible teacher, and leader trainer. Deanna plays piano and disciples the ladies. Zimbabwe ministry began more recently for us in late 2022. Our involvement there is to help train young pastors who are actively involved in planting churches. Specific prayer requests Exeter Bible Fellowship Church can be praying for. Effectiveness in the training of Sabella, a young man in the Kanana Church, who we hope will become the pastor of the church in years future and then carry it forward into the future. Right now, we'd appreciate prayers for him. He's finishing up a math degree. He's got some exams very shortly, and then he's got one more year to go. That'll then be his job. That would, we hope, provide his support so he can carry on the ministry. It'd have to be bivocational.
And for effectiveness in the Zimbabwe work, there's many internet issues or challenges that we face in between the times that we're there.
And in wisdom dealing with the demands and challenges involved in the Zimbabwe ministry, and also for increased cultural awareness.
and then for more young men to train in both countries.
We're due to visit Exeter in 2026 to report back, and at that time we'll give you way more information about the Zimbabwe ministry, but only to those who are in the church on the day.
Thank you for all your support and prayers for us all these years. We really appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi, I'm Marcia Montenegro, and my ministry is Christian Answers for the New Age. I've been doing this full-time since 1998. I really appreciate the support and prayers of Exeter Bible Fellowship. Thank you so much for that. I'm so grateful that you partner with this ministry. My ministry has two main purposes. The first one is to reach out to those in the New Age and the occult who are in bondage to these false beliefs and who need the truth and love of Jesus Christ. And the second goal is to inform the church of these areas so that they can be better equipped to reach out to people in the New Age and the occult, and also be more discerning about these things because the New Age is very mainstream in the culture. So those two areas keep me very busy. The New Age is a very vast area, and I've been doing a lot of speaking. I do a lot of writing and a lot of interviews. I've spoken in 30 states over the years, and I also have a number of interviews I've done on programs that you can find on places like YouTube and other platforms. They're also listed on my website along with a lot of articles that I've written, and that would be at christiananswersnewage.com. So please check out that website if you're interested. I have a lot of articles there. I was involved in the New Age for a number of years, for 20 years, and I was a professional astrologer. I was very much into Eastern religions, specifically Zen Buddhism, the last 10 of those years, and did the Buddhist meditation every day. So I'm very familiar with Eastern meditation, and I talk about that a lot. So these are all areas that I cover in my ministry. I've also had several articles published in Christian publications, and also I have two books, Spellbound, The Paranormal Seduction of Today's Kids, and The Enneagram, Richard Rohr and The Enneagram Secret, which is a book I wrote with two other people that came out in 2020. I do have some prayer requests. Number one would be that the Lord would continue to open doors for this ministry. He has been giving me many opportunities, and in fact, I think this past year has been one of the busiest years I've had. Also, prayer for my health to continue to be able to do this work. For my family as well, please pray for my son Jeffrey, who is dealing with a lot of challenges, and I know he would appreciate your prayers. I am so grateful for the partnership of Exeter Bible. I pray for all of you as well, and I pray for you as you serve the Lord. Thank you for being a partner with Christian Answers for the New Age. I am so grateful for being able to do this work and for you. Thank you.
My name is Ned Farns with greetings from Northeast Pennsylvania. Although my family and I are currently in the United States, we have served with Lebensell Mission USA in Ecuador since 2001. As many of you know, I grew up at Exeter Bible, where my family attended for more than 60 years. My current responsibility in Ecuador is children's ministry coordinator. We provide programming for children such as Vacation Bible School, Kids Clubs, English Day Camps, and Sunday School. We also support children's ministry workers through teacher training. Some of these things we would like to continue online during our time in the U.S. However, this has been complicated due to power outages caused by a lack of rain. So we would ask you to pray about this. In Ecuador, I also preach at different churches and teach at the Bible Institute. Marisol is also involved in different ministries, such as women's ministry. Our son Joel is a senior at Cedarville University studying organizations management. Last month, Amelia began a one-year program at Word of Life Bible Institute at Scroon Lake, New York. Twins Jacob and Elias study seventh grade at Canaan Christian School in Lake Ariel, Pennsylvania. We'd like to take a moment and thank you for your faithful support during all of these years of service in Ecuador. Without your generosity and prayers, we would not be able to do the work that we do in Ecuador. Thank you very much, and God bless.
My name is Gregory Miller, and this is my wife, Christine. And in 1977, I was a public school teacher, so they needed missionary teachers overseas, and teaching is a great part of missions, you know. We were Exeter Bible Church, and that's the church of my baptism, and the church of my ordination is Exeter Bible Church. And also our sending to the field at our first sending church, and so that's how we have happened to arrive and in Brazil. We started off working at a place called Amazon Valley Academy. This went until about 2008, and then we were served in a campground training center for the Brazilian church. We discovered that there's a time to leave, and we think, you know, God calls you, and, were we to stay there the rest of our lives and retire there? So he called us to do different things. So we came back I had a heart attack, and in the year 2008, we came back to the United States, and here we go. There it is. These are examples of the different materials that we use to print out and send. We have it in just about any language you can think of in the world. You know, you basically deal with English and Spanish.
As we receive the Bible lessons, then we correct them and include the new lesson and send them out. And our goal is each month to be sending out 250 lessons. Mostly the incarcerated.
And it's a great activity, I think, for our church or for retired missionaries. You can still be active and still reaching out, bringing the light of the gospel into very dark places.
We started this ministry at Source of Light International Missions, and we found that the greatest response came from the prison population, the incarcerated, and it's very fruitful. And it's being responded, and we even received new requests for more lessons from the prisoners. And so very fruitful, the prison ministry in itself.
And I think this is the light that comes into the darkness. And there it is, and it's tangible, and it's there. That's how I see it now.
And after each course, they receive a certificate. So that's always helpful as they apply for parole or something. They show their certificates, and they're great.
You know, when they're up for parole, they show their lessons. I've been studying the Bible and so on and so forth. I got a diploma and so forth. That helps. Hey, it's been wonderful. Exeter was a church that got us started on missions, and it's been with us for 50 years, you know, a long time. And we've appreciated everything, and the little packages and the visits and the prayers and the correspondence and everything, and you meant so much, not only us, but other missionaries too. I'm sure they'll say the same thing.
We thank you so much for all these years, and you've just been the mother church to us, and we thank you, brothers and sisters, for your prayer and support over these years.
Hi, my name is Vicki Martin. Vicky Martin is serving the Lord among the Isnag tribe in northern Luzon in the Philippines. She's so thankful for the many years the Lord has allowed her to serve him there. Her husband Galen and her arrived in 1980 in the Philippines, and in 2004 her husband went home to be with the Lord. So she's been serving the Lord there since 2005. Her main ministry is teaching women how to teach women, children, and teenage girls. She writes lessons and teaches them how to teach those lessons. She's working on lessons that include science about how our bodies work and God's word for the teenage girls. She also continues to teach the women who now run the clinic about health issues. She's also teaching the women how to sew kits for the teenage girls that they will introduce and give them once they teach them about their monthly periods. They have learned how to make reusable pads to include in those kits. She seems to be working herself out of a job. All the things that she used to do, she teaches the women to do now. She thanks the Lord for the group of women who are eager to grow in the Lord and are fun to teach. Please pray for wisdom for her and physical strength for each day. She really needs the Lord's direction in writing lessons. Praising Him, Vicky Martin.
Please pray that the Lord will keep the door open for us missionaries to continue to serve the Lord there.
I feel like there's such a huge stigma with homelessness, and I also feel like people think that it looks a certain way, and it doesn't. Like, I go into work, and I promise you, nobody there knows that I'm homeless. Like, nobody knows the situation. So I am from Schuylkill County, actually, until I moved out when I was 18, met the love of my life. I got pregnant real quick afterwards.
I'm joking about that, but I'm kidding.
It turned very abusive very quick. I was insanely depressed, very suicidal. So instead of moving in with my mom and my abusive stepfather, I was homeless. I was working with service access management, and my case manager recommended Lighthouse. Literally cannot describe the difference of my life. I've gotten so much help here and found so much hope because I was in a spot where I was hopeless. When you're living with a bunch of women with trauma, can be terrifying because we've all got bad days, we're all synced up. It can get really rough sometimes, but case management and the workers, and I mean, some of them are just like a light to our day that we would not have otherwise. Intervention that we would not have otherwise or in the real world. I love that we have our own room. I love that we have our own keys that our doors can lock and close. Just having the community is huge. There's always a group of kids or like at least one other kid playing that they can interact with in a time where we were severely isolated. I never thought that I would be able to buy a house in the next 5 years, and now it looks like I could potentially do it in 6 months. So I'm pushing, I am saving, I am paying stuff off, I'm doing what I can. I would love to buy us a house. I would love to get us stability and to continue pushing. I'm in a job that I love, that I literally prayed for and did not think was possible, and it came. We are pushing. We are choo-choo trains chugging along.
Pregnancy, parenting, it can all be hard. And when you throw in the additional complications of an unexpected pregnancy and pressure from people around you, it's easy to see how so many women can be persuaded to choose an abortion. So how do we convince mothers to choose life when we know how difficult that choice can be?
I was in a heavy situation. And I literally went into hiding, I swear.
Wasn't planned pregnancy at all. I already have a six-year-old, didn't really have too many resources. My family was states away.
And if it wasn't for Genesis, I would have probably still been stuck.
Our clients come to us with many needs. We have the ability to offer pregnancy testing, ultrasounds, STD testing and treatment, and advocacy. We provide truth and real assistance to all our women, no matter what their need. We become the very hands and feet of Jesus, providing all the things a mother needs to handle the pregnancy and assist the needs of their family. We share the message of hope in Jesus and recommend a local church in their area to get connected to a church family where they can continue to grow and receive even more support. Genesis creates a bridge from fear that results in the hope for the future.
The next day I was in for an appointment and they just blessed me with so many things. It was like over inundated with like child supplies.
After talking to her, we both were in tears. The way she encouraged, you know, you can have it, it's okay, it's worth it. And with her, we'll not let this go. We'll take it forward. I thought it was just the God who came through her and spoke all of those words.
My kid is now 4, and Miss Wendy has never let go of my hand from that day. And she always get me to cry.
For almost 40 years, Genesis Women's Clinic has been providing support to women who are experiencing crisis pregnancies. Throughout the years, we have expanded our range of services from providing basic necessities to offering counseling, community, and medical services at our clinic with the purpose of helping women make life-affirming choices. Genesis Women's Clinic is making an impact in our local community.
Get a break sometimes. You need that. We all need that. So,
in 2022, we had 768 appointments with women who needed material assistance, ultrasounds, counseling, and pregnancy and STD testing. The women who seek our assistance are truly in need, and all the services we offer to women facing crisis pregnancies are completely free. That's why we rely on the support of our community to continue our operations.
When you team up with Genesis, you enable us to continue to walk with these women in their time of need. Your support allows our center to be a beacon of life and hope in our dark world and in our communities.
We got to know that it was a baby girl last week, so you're more happy.
Thank you so much for everything you have given to me and my children. Just knowing that you guys are out there, it made me feel a lot better about choosing life, and it made me feel like I wasn't alone.
Please don't stop ever helping, because even if you don't see us come out, we see that you're helping.
Sounds really strong.
Sounds great.
I just can't wait to meet my baby and see my baby's face.
Good morning, Exeter Bible Fellowship. I'm Debbie Stutzman. I'm the Executive Director of Mercy Ministries. Thank you so much for your continued support. Without churches like you, we would not be able to give the services that we do to the women of Reading. Our mission is to love, encourage, and equip her so she can choose life. Just last week, we had an abortion-minded woman come through our doors. Praise the Lord. She came to us. We were able to sit and talk with her, listen to her, value her, and let her know that she doesn't have just one option of abortion. Rather, she can also choose to parent or make an adoption plan. After listening to her and talking with her, she then was asked if she would want to see the approximate size of her baby. She said that she would be willing to see that. And when she held that little baby in her hands, everything changed. See, at Mercy, our goal is to go ultrasound. We can't imagine the impact that will be able to make for our community. With your support, we will be able to continue to reach toward our goal of ultrasound. We know ultrasound will make a huge impact in our community here in Reading. Our current needs or diapers size 5 and 6. We also need items for a Christmas Klein event. We need toys for infants 0 to a year, as well as for ages 1 to 6, dolls and trucks. We also like to give each of the moms a little Christmas outfit for each of the children, and that would again be for the infants size 0 to 12 months. So if you are willing to do any of that, we would greatly appreciate that, and that will make Christmas a little bit brighter for each one of our clients. We do have some volunteer opportunities available as well. Our event team can always use fresh ideas and new people to be able to help make each of our fundraisers, which we only have 2, successful each year. So if you have the gift of great ideas and outgoing personality, that is exactly what we need for that position. Also, we are in dire need of volunteer peer advocates. This is a woman who exhibits the love of Jesus and the fruits of the Spirit. If the Lord is tugging at your heart and you want to know more, please give us a call. We can discuss it with you. And if you do feel that it might be something that you're interested in, we will give you all the training that you need to be successful. Thank you for partnering with us. Thank you for the supplies that you've given us, such as diapers and wipes, and also doing the baby bottle boomerang. All those things help us to keep our doors open and encourage us as a staff as well, knowing that we have the support of our local churches. Thank you.
As the ushers come forward to take the morning offering this morning, let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you once again for the opportunity to gather here this morning, for the chance to come together to praise and worship you, to lift your name up, and to exalt and to glorify the King of Kings, for the opportunity to gather together as a local church body, for fellowship, to lift each other up, and to hear your word preached. Lord, we thank you for the love that you have for us, Lord, and that your love never fails, and that there's absolutely nothing that can separate us from your love. Lord, we pray for those individuals this morning who are struggling, Lord, physically or emotionally, or whether they're struggling spiritually. Lord, we pray for your strength and for your healing. Lord, we know that we can cry out to you and that you hear us when we do. And this morning, as we come together for Mission Sunday, Lord, we think of the video we just watched and all the missionaries that we support here at Exeter Bible Fellowship. Lord, the Farnsworths, the Heathcotes, the Millers, Vicki Martin, Marsha Montenegro, and for the local ministries, Lord, that we support, the Genesis Women's Clinic, Mercy Ministries, and Hope Rescue Mission. Lord, thank you for the encouraging updates that we just heard, Lord, and for the work that you're doing through each and every one of these ministries and missionaries. Lord, we pray for each and every one of them, Lord. We pray for your protection over them. We pray for strength each day as they serve you in various ways. We pray for your wisdom and for your guidance, Lord, in their ministries. Lord, I thank you for the various local ministries that you have raised up out of this church. Lord, the food pantry, the care team, ESL, the women's ministries, and numerous other ones. Lord, I thank you for the leaders and for the men, the women, and children who volunteer for these ministries. Lord, I thank you for those that serve this church in numerous other ways. I know that there are so many in this church, in this congregation, Lord, who see a need and who step up and fill it. And Lord, I praise you for that. I pray that you continue to give this church and every man, woman, and child here a heart to serve you and to share your love with others. Lord, we know that whether it's the missionaries serving you in a foreign field, whether it's working in the local ministries here, Lord, whether it's leaving here today, being with family, whether it's going to a job tomorrow morning or the job of staying home to take care of the family, Lord, you have called each of us to serve you in various ways. So as we leave here today, as we head out this week to where you have called us to serve you, Lord, we know that is not through our strength, but is through yours. Help us to lead godly lives, lives that honor and glorify you. Help us to be an example for you. Lord, help us to always have an answer for the hope that we have in you. And as Pastor Steve comes this morning to deliver the message, I pray that you'll prepare our hearts to hear your word. Thank you for Pastor Steve, for the church that you have started through him in Maryland, Lord, and for the work that you are doing down there. Lord, and we're excited to hear him bring your word this morning. We pray all this in your name. Amen.
We have our offering containers passing right now, and we're going to do one song before we do one more shorter video to update you on the immediate ministries here in Exeter BFC before we hear from Pastor Steve. But if you're able, let's stand again and sing together of the love of God. Play our shorter video with our local specific EBFC ministries right now, and then I will come back up and introduce our guest speaker, Pastor Steve. So let's check out what's been going on or what's upcoming here at EBFC.
Good morning, Exeter BFC. My name's Nate Art. I just recently had an opportunity to serve down in South Carolina with my company, Rhodes Energy. A few years ago, our company signed up to be on the natural disaster relief with delivering fuel. And just after Hurricane Helene, I had the opportunity to go down south and help out and deliver fuel and offer people a gallon of hope, 1 gallon at a time. When I was down south, I seen many people come together just helping people, just giving people warm smiles, giving people bottles of water, a bag of ice. There's anything that you can do to help serve. It was greatly appreciated down south. Every morning before I got to my assignment, I used to say the prayer from Psalm 90, and establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. I believe that God was establishing the work of my hands to bring people a hope. I'm very thankful for the opportunity, for the people I got to meet, pray for, or just give a warm smile. Sometimes we have opportunities that are laid before us and we don't know what they're going to be. So anytime that God gives you an opportunity to serve him, sometimes we have to be willing in a moment's notice. It could be in our own neighborhood. It could be a couple hundred miles away in South Carolina, driving a truck, delivering gas, or it could be your neighbor next door. Missionary work doesn't always have to be abroad. It can be local or near or wherever. It can even be in this church, offering somebody a warm smile who is downcast. Anything that we do in Jesus' name is an opportunity to serve him. Here at Exeter, I know there's so many opportunities here where you can help serve. You don't have to worry about going abroad. You can be a helpful impact here in Exeter Township, or even in the over in the city of Reading, or down the road in Birdsboro. And now you're going to hear other ministry opportunities we have here at Exeter BFC. Thank you for taking the time to listen to me. I pray that you will get connected and bring glory to God through service.
It's a beautiful day here at Exeter Bible Church in the back parking lot. We're here serving, handing out food today. It's been really, really busy. Again, our turnout has been somewhat overwhelming a little. Some of our food is diverted to help the people in North Carolina and maybe as far as Florida. So we're thankful that food can be redirected over there. We're using tablets again for check-in. We have extra translators and mobile devices for Wi-Fi, allow us to use the tablets. So our check-in process is going really, really great. On average, we're serving 330 families. We expect for Thanksgiving to it increase. Last year, we served about 450 over the Thanksgiving holiday. We probably have 200 cars on maybe average. Some families get as high as 8 servings of food and product. Very seldom do we get cars with one family. Parking is at a premium. We fill up both of the parking lots, and today we even filled up the middle parking lot, the U section that we call it. If anyone wants to help in the food pantry, we'd be open to helpers any Saturday that you can help. You don't have to help every week, but on-the-job training is what we broadcast to everybody. You can reach me here at church or via the email at exeterbfc.org. So thanks for all the volunteers that show up week in, week out, and the extras that have signed up again this month. So we just thank you for all that we can do to serve the community.
Hi, my name is Jim Murphy. I'm a coordinator of the care team here at Exeter Bible Fellowship Church. And what we do, we try to relieve some of the pressures for members when they return from the hospital or have babies or from extended illness, just things we can do, like make meals. We supply meals for people, just take some of the pressure off. In the last year, so we coordinated 16 meal schedules, and we delivered over 90 meals. And as far as other things we do, I guess one of the main things would be driving. When people need to go to doctor's appointments and they can't drive themselves, they can call us. We have drivers that'll take them to doctor's appointments. We can help with picking up groceries or taking them to grocery stores. And in the past year, we've scheduled over 50 rides for church members. You know, we can always use more helpers with the care team, particularly drivers. If someone has time during the day and they can give a little bit of that time when needed to take a member to a doctor's appointment or to help go to a grocery store, we appreciate that. That would really be helpful. If anyone has the time, please see me. Give me a call or see me at church.
Good morning. My name is Grace Art, and I am excited to announce that Exeter BFC will be starting an ESL program here in 2025. ESL is English Second Language and is a great way to reach out the community, help folks learn English, and to connect and build relationships. We're planning to start in 2025, so please reach out to myself, Lindsay Kell, or Carolyn Bainey if you're interested in volunteering and helping out with this new ministry. If you're interested in volunteering, we will have our first planning meeting on November 3rd, which is coming up real quick. So if you have any interest in helping with food, prayer, lesson planning, any number of ways that you can help, let us know right away so we can get you signed up for our meeting next week. There's a sign-up sheet down at our welcome desk.
Just a quick little summary there. If you guys are interested in being involved in any of those ministries that we just watched, obviously there's some information about that stuff in the e-bulletin, but there's specific paper sign-ups that you can give your basic information to so that those volunteer leaders can follow up with you guys and get you plugged in. As you can tell, there's a lot going on, not just out there in the world, but here at Exeter BFC, and I want to give a thank you to everyone who's been involved in those things. There's one other opportunity with the food pantry, which I know Pam was handing some of these out already, but for the next month at least, we're doing a food drive, and there's a cart down there, so you guys can find some information about that at the help desk, and there will be more next week in the e-bulletin. But right now, I'm going to ask our guest speaker today, Pastor Steve Morton, to come on up and give us our message. And there's some connection here with the church and Pastor Bill, but we've been supporting their church plant for at least the last year now, and I know he's going to give you a little bit more of that information, but let's give him a warm welcome as he brings us the word today.
Thanks, Lee. Appreciate it. Good morning. Lee, thank you for that wonderful introduction. You did a fantastic job. Give him a hand for doing that. it is a joy to be here with you this morning. As he said, I'm a church planter with the Bible Fellowship Church down in Elkton, Maryland, and it's a delight of mine to be here with you. It's a joy always to be with God's people, worshiping our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. And so to gather with you this morning to do that very thing, it just brings joy to my heart, and I expect and anticipate it brings joy to your heart as well. But not only that, it's a joy to be here with your pastor, Pastor Bill. I know he's around here. I can't see him very well, but Pastor Bill Burton is one that I have known for many, many years. For he and I were a part of the Bible Fellowship Church of Newark down in Delaware, and he precedes me there at the church in Newark. He was a young man. He was involved with their youth group, but we both were under the lead pastor of Pastor Bill Sloniker, and I know Pastor Bill Sloniker had a tremendous influence on Bill Burton's life, and the Lord has used Pastor Bill in my life, Pastor Bill Sloniker, that is, in my life as well. So I can't say enough great things about your pastor, the Pastor Bill Burton. He's a friend of mine. He loves the Word of God, and not only that, but he loves his church, and he loves you, and it's evident when I talk with him just about all those things are true, and I just am thrilled and I consider it a blessing to be here with you this morning. But just to give you a little bit of information about myself, as I said, I've been a pastor. I served at the church there in Newark for 20 years. I started off as the senior high youth director. And then during my years there, I went to seminary online. I became ordained, and when I last was involved with the Church of Newark, I was the pastor of outreach and mission. And so I'm delighted that you're a mission-oriented church. I loved all the testimonies and love that you are prayerfully and supporting them financially as well. And I have been the benefit of that as well as a church planter, for you have been a big part of the reason why we've started there in Elkton. I am married. My family was not able to be here. They're actually back at the church in Elkton, making sure things are running okay there. We're coming up on our one-year anniversary. We launched, had our first public service on November 5th of 2023, and we started off with 25 of us, and on a given Sunday now, we're about at around 35 folks. On a good Sunday, we'll have 40, maybe even 45, and so we're excited about what the Lord is doing there. But so my wife is back there. I have four children. They're older now. Most of them are older. My oldest son is 28. His name is TJ. He lives in northern New Jersey, and he works as an electrical engineer. I have a daughter who is 24 years old, who was married 2 years ago to my son-in-law, whose name is Noah Given. And I love the name that my daughter now has, because her name is Grace, and now her new married name is Grace Given. So I felt like that was ordained by God from the very beginning of time. I've been married for 2 years, and she's been involved with our church plants. I have another daughter, Lily, who is 20. She is a student, a junior at York College of Pennsylvania. She's studying to be a nuclear medical technologist. She not only is a student there, but she plays volleyball, so we get to see her play some volleyball there. And then I have our wonderful surprise child, Isaac, who's 14 years old. Is in the eighth grade and is looking to be the next Jalen Hurts of the NFL. So that's a little bit about my children and my family. I actually just celebrated our 32nd wedding anniversary on October 24th to my wife, Nikki. And it's been a great, great time to be with her and growing our family. And so as a church planter in Elkton, we have felt the Lord lead us to start a church there. As a pastor of outreach and mission, I had been involved with another of church planting opportunities in the Delmarva region. And honestly, your pastor, Pastor Bill, was also kind of an encourager for me to pursue church planting, as he himself was a church planter, as you probably know. And 5 years ago, grew up in Delaware, or I should say my wife grew up in Delaware, but we lived in Delaware all my married life. But 5 years ago, we had the opportunity to buy a property in Elkton, Maryland, which is right across the border from Delaware. It's about 20 minutes away from where we were living. And when we moved there, you know, in my role, I was involved with some church planting efforts. One, the Mission Church down in Townsend. And David Gundrum, who oversees our church planting effort with the BFC, has been encouraging me to consider church planting. All the while, I was like, no, we feel like the Lord has us where he wants us to be. But when we moved to Elkton, we saw a great opportunity, I thought, to see of expanding the fellowship of churches that make up the BFC. And because at our church in Newark, we had about 50 folks that were coming from Maryland to attend the church there in Newark. And in Elkton, it's the county seat for Cecil County. And there were a number of good churches in the area, a lot of Baptist, Methodist, mainline churches, but there weren't many churches like the BFC. And so after praying and discussing with my wife, the Lord led us to begin this church plant. And our mission as a church plant there in Elkton is to know Jesus, to grow in a relationship with him, and to go with his gospel. Now, as a young person, you know, I grew up originally in the D.C. area. My parents would take us, my sister, I have a sister that is six years older than I, and we would always go to church. And my idea of being a Christian meant just going to church and being a good person. Have you been there? Do you understand that? Maybe that's part of your background. And that's how I lived, you know, being a relatively good person, go to church, and stay out of trouble. And as I said, I have a sister that's 6 years older than me, and when she got into her high school years, I noticed a change in her. She became involved with a ministry called Young Life. If you're familiar with Young Life, it's like Campus Crusade for Christ at the high school level. And I saw that she was, one, making a lot of friends, and they were doing a lot of great, fun activities. But I did notice a change in her as well, and I thought, when I get to high school, I too want to become involved with this ministry called Young Life. And so as I got into ninth grade, I had the opportunity to go to one of their camps in upstate New York. And it was there that I heard the gospel. You know, I understood now then, you know, from the messages that were being given was that Jesus or God wanted to have a relationship with me. And it wasn't based on me just being a good person and or going to church, but it was about having a relationship with him. And it was explained about how God initiated that relationship with us by sending his son Jesus to live a life that you and I could never live. We can't be perfect, for God is holy and perfect. And but he came on a mission to give his life as a ransom for mine. And so that any that would profess faith in Jesus could begin that relationship and live for him. And so that's what I better understood at that young age of young life, when I was in young life, is that God loved me. And that sin was what separated me from him, and that Jesus came on a rescue mission, and that he gives an invitation to all of us to put our faith and trust in him so that we can know him, have that relationship, and grow with him. And ever since that time, when I came to put my faith in Christ through that ministry, I felt that call to share that hope, that message with those that I came in contact with. And when I became involved with the church here at Bible Fellowship Church, that's what I intended to do. And as I became the pastor of outreach and mission, you know, with my heart and want to introduce people to Jesus Christ, I found that most of my time was being involved with other Christians, with other Christian activities. And it caused me to question, what am I doing? Is it doing what God wants me to do? Paul Tripp had mentioned, given a phrase to the challenge that some of us Christians can find ourselves in when we're just always around other Christians and we're not out actually in our communities sharing the hope that we have in Christ. And he called that the Christian ghetto. And it means that we surround ourselves with Christians and we rarely interact with those outside of our circles. And I found that that was true of me. That I would constantly be looking to try to get folks involved with church activities, to volunteer as a youth leader, or to be involved with men's ministries or women's ministries or small groups. And those are all great things. Don't get me wrong. Those are good, valuable things. But it caused me to think, now if Jesus is calling us to be the light of the world, and that we're to let our light shine before others, how was I doing with that? How was I doing about letting our light, my light, shine before others so that they might see or know the hope that they can have in Jesus Christ? I mean, Jesus, he could have stayed up in heaven, right? He could have stayed in his comfortable area, but he came on a mission. He came down to earth. It says, the Apostle Paul talks about in Philippians that he humbled himself. He became like us, like man. And then he, not only was he man, but he endured the shame of people of ridiculing him and questioning him and ultimately spitting on him and putting him to death. And he did that on a purpose so that he could give his life and die on a cross in order to bring us to his Father in heaven. And so this morning, I felt the call to consider how to stir us to love and good works, right? And we're going to look at a passage that you're probably very familiar with. It's in Luke chapter 10. It's known as the Good Samaritan parable. And if you have your Bibles, we're going to be reading starting in verse 25 and going through verse 37. But a little bit of a background before I read this. You know, Luke is kind of divided in the first 10 chapters or 9 chapters are the time that Jesus was doing his ministry in Galilee. And then the last 5 chapters is when he's in Jerusalem going to the cross. And in between, it's known as sometimes known as the travel narrative. And it's here where Jesus is spending a lot of time in the country of Samaria, or the town or towns of Samaria. And if you're familiar with Samaritans and Jewish people, they didn't really get along. They didn't really necessarily like each other. And what we're going to read here in this Good Samaritan parable is most likely as Jesus is in or near or around Samaria at the time of sharing this parable. And so what we're going to do now, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and open up with me. The Apostle Paul encouraged Timothy that you should stay committed to the public reading of his word. So we're going to read the whole parable right now. So in Luke chapter 10, starting in verse 25, it says this, "And behold, a lawyer stood up and put him to the test, that is Jesus, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' And he said to him, 'What is written in the law? How do you read it?' And he answered, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself.' And he said to him, 'You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live.' And he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, 'And who is my neighbor?' Jesus replied, 'A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. And he went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, 'Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back.' Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." And Jesus said to him, "You go and do likewise." So if we look at the first few verses here, in verses 25 to 29, we see that there's this lawyer that engages with Jesus, and he asks Jesus a question. Now, to be a lawyer during that time meant that you were an expert in God's law. Essentially, he was a Bible scholar. He was a theologian. And this man knew the Torah, most likely. He knew the Old Testament. And so his asking Jesus of this question wasn't because he was wanting to get knowledge from him. He was saying this question as a means to test Jesus. And I would say it was more of a test to try to discern what kind of teacher is Jesus. You see, the lawyer referred to Jesus as teacher. And so he was probably asking this question as a diagnostic type of question. And what do I mean by that? Well, I don't know if you are familiar with James Kennedy and the two questions that encourages Christians to ask to get a gauge of where someone is spiritually. Do you know what those two questions are? Those questions are the following. It says, the first question is, if you were to die tonight, do you know for sure that you would be with God in heaven? It's a fair question to ask, to kind of gauge, and you kind of listen to their response to kind of know or hear their understanding of what it means to be with God or how to be with God. And then he asked a second follow-up question. If God were to ask you why I should let you into my heaven, what would you say? And so this lawyer, when he asked Jesus that question, the question being, What shall I do to inherit eternal life? He knew the answer that God had from the Old Testament, but he was trying to ask a diagnostic type of question to Jesus, to get a gauge for what kind of teacher Jesus was. And so Jesus, being God, responds to the question that the lawyer asked by saying, well, what does the law say? And then he asks a further clarification, like, how do you understand the scriptures? And so the lawyer responds by saying that you're to love God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. And that's a good answer. That's taken from Deuteronomy 6 and taken from Leviticus 19. And then the Ten Commandments summarizes that concept very well. And Jesus says, you're right. If you do this, then you will live. But then the lawyer wants to get further clarification from Jesus. In response to, you know, if one is to love God and to love their neighbor with all that they have, he understood that the person is to do this all the time, continuously, every day, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. And so if we are in near or around Samaria, like, he's trying to better understand, do I need to, you know, I can love God, but to love others as myself, to love my neighbor as myself, who does that mean? Is it just mean other Jewish people? I can do that. But if they're near Samaria, does it mean the people that live in Samaria? I'm sure this lawyer, I'm sure he was very religious. I'm sure he was very upright. And I'm sure he wanted to do the right thing. But what we see in verse 29 is that the lawyer says this, desiring to justify himself, he asked the question, who is my neighbor? So he moves from trying to ask a question to challenge or trip up Jesus to trying to rationalize his own life and the way that he treats people by asking the question, who is my neighbor? I mean, he couldn't mean to love everyone all the time, could he? That's too broad. That's a hard thing to do. So Jesus then responds with a story to his question. Because the question really isn't who is my neighbor, but whose neighbor am I? So if we look at starting in verse 30, Jesus shares a story so that it can really connect the listener to a real place, a real possibility. For there is a road that goes from Jerusalem to Jericho. And it's a road that's known to be a treacherous place. Some commentaries refer to this was known as the Bloody Way. And this was an ideal place where thieves or bandits would look to take advantage of somebody that was traveling by themselves. They would ambush them. And in this story, Jesus shares about a man that was beaten and left for dead. Now, we don't know anything about this person that is beaten up. We don't know if it's a Jewish person. We don't know if it's a person from Samaria. And that's not the point of this story. All we know is this, is that he's a bloody mess, and he's in need of help. And so there's two people that come upon this man who were religious people. There's a priest and a Levite. A Levite is someone that is set apart to serve God in the temple. And they're coming, perhaps they're coming back from temple, going to their homes. And maybe they were in a rush to get back home. We don't really know. All we know is that when they saw this man beaten up and left for dead, they passed him by. And maybe there were reasons why they didn't want to bother. I mean, there are some laws in the Old Testament about if you touch a dead body, it causes you to be unclean, and you have to go through a process to become clean again. And maybe they were wanting to get back to their families, or maybe they were getting ready to go to church or to temple, and they didn't want to make themselves unclean. We don't know. That's speculation on my part. But all we do know is that these are two people that I think, and you would expect, someone that has a religious heritage, that most likely they should have stopped to help this person. But they didn't. But what we do know is that they lacked compassion, and they were unwilling to show mercy. And I would say to you that these religious leaders in this particular story were bad neighbors, if you will. And so some of the characteristics, I would say, of a bad neighbor are found in this story. You know, a bad neighbor avoids people in obvious need. A bad neighbor has little concern for those who are injured, certainly physically, but I would add also maybe spiritually, anybody that's injured in that way. Another characteristic is a bad neighbor is someone that more likely was worshiping God in temple, and when they left, their heart is as hard as it was before they went into temple. And lastly, a bad neighbor characteristic is someone who refuses to help someone in need. And so the next person that comes into this story is a Samaritan. And if you were a Jewish person listening to this story, as this lawyer was a Jewish person, I'm sure the hairs on your neck would stand on end. Because I said Samaritans and Jewish people just did not get along. No Samaritan could be respected in the eyes of a Jewish person. The Apostle John, in his Gospel of John, in John chapter 4, verse 9, he says this, "For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." And so we now understand in this story that the Jewish and Samaritans didn't get along, and so I'm sure there was angst among some of the Jewish people that were hearing this story. But yet here we have a Samaritan who is stopping to help this person who was left for dead. And I imagine what he does, he cleans him up, he bandages his wounds, he puts him on his donkey, takes him to an inn, and he feeds him and he leaves him some money to help him get better. And then he says, "Hey, I'm going to go away, but I'm going to come back and I'm going to check on him." I mean, who does that? It's a remarkable story. But not only was it remarkable, the story itself remarkable, but the main character is someone that is despised by the Jews. And so I imagine that many of the people that were hearing that was just having a hard time dealing with the truth that the main character, the star of this story, was a Samaritan man. So Jesus then asked this lawyer, which of the three proved to be a neighbor? And I'm sure this lawyer is trying to think of any way to avoid saying the Samaritan was, but he finally relents by simply saying the one who showed mercy. Which I find interesting because you would think maybe he would just say, well, the Samaritan, but I think because it shows the disdain that he has for the Samaritan, he couldn't even say that. He couldn't even say that word. All he could say is, "Well, the one who showed mercy is the one who proved to be a neighbor." And so Jesus then says, "Well, go and do likewise." So, as I said, the real question of this story is not who is my neighbor, but whose neighbor am I? And so one other way that we can ask the question is, how can I, you and I, today, how can we treat people in a neighborly way. If God says that we're to love God with all our heart, soul, and mind, and love our neighbor as ourself, then to ask the question for the second part, how can we love others in a neighborly way? In other words, you know, if Jesus tells us that we are the light of the world and that we are to shine our light before others in this world, how can we shine the light to the world? How effective can we be that if we're always just in our Christian holy huddles? I think we need to be intentional. We need to be purposeful to be in our communities, in the world, so that the light of God in us would shine to those that don't yet know Jesus as their Lord. You know, a number of years ago, I read a book that's entitled The Art of Neighboring, Building Genuine Relationships Right Outside Your Door. And in that, the authors state that neighboring, being a good neighbor, starts in our hearts when we develop flexibility and compassion. Often we get so focused on getting to where we need to be or doing the next thing that we don't take time to interact with people in our very own neighborhoods. You know, I don't know about you, but, you know, I'm 57 years old. And when I was a young boy and where I lived in the suburbia of Washington, D.C., I knew my neighbors like five houses up from me on my left and on my right. I knew my neighbors across the street. I knew some neighbors around the corner. But today, I barely know my neighbors to my left and right, much less five houses up from me to the left or right. I would say that it doesn't seem like our culture, maybe, I don't know if that's true for you or not, but my sense is that in our culture, we don't value people as much as we once did. Another story that I heard over the last couple years is, it's a post 9/11 story, and it's about a manager who managed the restaurant that was on the top of the World Trade Center, called Top of the World Restaurant, I think it was. And he discovered the fact that he didn't see people as people when he was managing people. Instead, he just saw the people that he was around as waiters or waitresses, as kitchen staff, as planners, or so on. And in this story, it reveals that he's kind of sharing it with tears in his eyes as he's going to these funerals of people that he used to work with that died in that 9/11 attack. And he was sitting next to the husbands and the wives and the sons and daughters of those that had died. And he just kept thinking, I didn't take time to get to know these people as people. I didn't get to know their stories. So in order to be neighborly, to love our neighbor as ourself, as a reflection because we love God, we need to develop flexibility and compassion. And we need to see people as people. You know, too often we just interact with people for the roles that we see them in. You know, when you go out to a restaurant, we see the person that waits on us as our server, or we go to Walmart and check out, and the person that's our checkout person, that's all that we see them as. But I would encourage you to develop time and flexibility and show compassion. One of the ways that you can do is, I heard a story of a person that makes a point of every time he goes out to a restaurant. By show of hands, how many of you guys ever go out to eat dinner? I'm assuming most of you do. Well, in this story, a person shares about when the person comes to take their order, you know, he always makes a point to say, hey, they give their order and say, listen, we're Christians and we always like to pray before we receive our meal. Is there anything in particular we could be praying for you? And in this one particular story, the person that was their server kind of didn't know how to react and said, no, I don't have anything, and he walked away. But then, not long after, he came back to the table and said, you know what, there is something you can pray for. You know, I just learned that my girlfriend is pregnant, and I don't know what to do. I don't know how to be a dad. If you can pray for that. It's amazing what people are willing to share with you. If you just simply ask the question, is there something that I can be praying for? I've begun to do that, try to make that a regular part of my daily activities as I'm out and about, in particular as I go out to eat. And it's amazing the things that people will share. You know, I certainly have, you know, the typical, oh, just pray for good health, you know. But then there's others that say, yeah, I'm divorced and my wife and my children are, I don't get to see them as much. Pray for that. Or I've had others that say, yeah, my son has cancer. They're in the hospital. Can you pray for that? It's amazing what people are willing to share when you simply take time and ask them, what can I be praying for? As I said, one of my hopes is to encourage you how to stir us to love and good works. Hebrews 10, 24, 25 says, let's consider how to stir one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. And so I want to encourage us how we can think of how we can be a good neighbor for the purpose of being a light for Jesus, literally in the communities where we exist and where we live. And I'm going to share another thing that I've come across over the last couple of years. It's an acronym. The acronym is the word BLESS. And if you think about how can you be a blessing, how can you be a light bearer for Christ, think of this word BLESS and use it as an acronym. And the first B stands for begin with prayer. Pray that the Lord would provide you opportunities, divine appointments, if you will, to be able to engage people where they are with God. And as you interact with people, just begin to pray with them, pray for them by name. You know, as a person serves you and they say, hey, my name is Steve, I'm here to serve you. Pray for Steve or Dan or whatever that person's name is. Many of you probably have smartphones and you probably have many different apps. You can download a prayer app. You know, and if you choose to pray for others and ask them what you can be praying for, put it down, write it down on a notepad or put it in your app on your phone and pray for them. And then if you go back to a particular restaurant and you see that person, just say, hey, Dan, I remember you asked me to pray for XYZ. How's that going? It would be interesting to see where that would lead you. The second letter in the word bless is L, and that stands for listen. So to be a good neighbor, to love others, to love your neighbor as yourself, ask questions. People like to talk about themselves, surprisingly. I remember when I graduated high school, I became a volunteer leader with Young Life, and I would go and meet students on campus, and I would ask them questions. And there was this one time, this kid asked me, he says, are you a reporter or something? Because you're asking me a ton of questions. But people like to talk about themselves. So listen. Third letter in the word bless is E, and it stands for eat. How many of you guys like to eat? I think many of you like to eat. You know, maybe you can invite people over to your home for a meal. That may not be as common of a practice today, but one thing you do if you're working, you know, go out to lunch with your coworkers. Or, hey, meet somebody for a cup of coffee. That's a fairly acceptable practice today. Gather together with people that don't know the Lord, as to your knowledge, doesn't have a relationship with the Lord, and just have meals with them, or go and get a cup of coffee. Get to know them. Food's a great way to connect with people. The fourth letter, S, stands for serve. And ask questions like, how can I help you? You know, as you engage in conversation with people, you'll learn some things that they're doing, like, I got to put up a fence because my dog got out and killed my neighbor's chickens. And, hey, can I help you build your fence? Offer ways to serve. You know, as a youth director, one of the things that we would do every year is we would take our youth group to Pine Brook to do something called RWR, which means retreat within a retreat. And our youth group would serve as the waiters and the cleanup crew for other groups. I went to Pine Brook for a retreat. And our group went, and they didn't get paid. They just went as a volunteer. But here's the interesting thing. At the end of the year, we would always have a graduation ceremony, if you will, for the graduating seniors. And we would ask them to give a highlight of their youth ministry. What are some highlights? And just so many of them said, you know what, the highlight for me is when we served on RWR. When they served to clean toilets, you know, they said that was our highlight. So when people serve, it makes an impression. And the last S stands for story. So as you develop relations, as you pray for others, as you listen to them, as you share meals with them, as you serve them, then God will provide, I believe, opportunities for you to share your story. Your story of faith, how you have put your faith and trust in Jesus. Because at that point, I think many folks will trust you and be willing to hear what you have to say. I'm not saying that's the only way to do evangelism, but I'm saying that that is a way. And that's one of the things as a church planter in Elton, I keep telling our people, we're in this for the long haul. We want to develop relationships with people in our community. We want to pray that God would give us divine opportunities, divine appointments, so that we can eventually share our story. Some we can share with it right away. Other times it will be through developing those relationships. So I would say to you as a means, a little bit past 11:30, so I'll try to finish up here. You know, look for opportunities in your own communities with which you can develop and begin to develop these kinds of relationships. Like if you like to barbecue, invite your neighbors to come over for a barbecue. If you have kids, you know, many times you play in your backyard. I've heard of one family, they had their kids play in their front yards as a means to just try to meet other families in the community. If you see opportunities of somebody in your community that needs help, maybe your neighbor's lawn is kind of high and they need someone to cut the grass, maybe you can offer to cut the grass. I don't know what it might be. What it does require, it requires us to be flexible and compassionate and engage people as people. Be a blessing. Who knows what the Lord might do? I'm not familiar with all the towns around Exeter, but and maybe some of you are coming from outside of Exeter to come to church here, but maybe the Lord might be using you to start a BFC church in your community. Who knows? Maybe God will start a Bible study in your home. Whatever it might be, may God receive all the glory because you were willing to be flexible and compassionate and see people as people. You see, Jesus, he could have stayed up in heaven. He could have stayed where it was comfortable. Jesus came down to earth on a mission to rescue us, to restore us into a relationship with his Father in heaven. And the way that he was able to do that is he would offer forgiveness of your sin and my sin by offering himself to die on a cross so that God's wrath for our sin can be poured out on him. Peter says that he did that on purpose in order that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh but made alive in the spirit. And then he commissioned his disciples to become apostles and to go and make more disciples. And you and I, for those that have made a profession of faith that Jesus is our Lord, he said he's going to come again. And he's prepared for works for us to do in advance that we would do them. He saved us by faith and through his grace. That's the basis of our salvation. But he's also prepared us to be his workmanship. He's created good works for us to do in advance that we would walk in them. And I believe the way that we can do that is by being his light in the communities where we live. Let's pray. Our Father and God, we thank you for your word to us today. We thank you for your story of the Good Samaritan. And God, I pray that you would help us to see, to follow the example that your son Jesus gave to us, that you left your comforts of heaven and came to earth on a mission. On a rescue mission to save us, to offer forgiveness of our sin, to restore us into a relationship that you originally intended us to have, to trust you, to know you, and to delight in you and to enjoy you. But because our sin was what separated from us from you, that you provided a solution for that. And so, Father, now you have called us to love you with all that we have. All our heart, all our soul, all our mind, all our strength. But also to love our neighbor as ourselves. So, Father, I pray as we draw closer to you that you would embed and just cause a fire in us that we would want to love those around us and introduce people to your Son, Jesus. God, we thank you for all that you do for us through your Son, Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Steve, I'll ask you to stay right there because we're just going to wrap things up here in just a second. As you've heard, there's obviously many things going on, not just here, but even as Steve mentioned, there's opportunities in each and every single one of our lives to be able to do ministry in our own way for the glory of God. And if you have questions about any ways that you specifically can get involved in those missions, I want to encourage you to talk to staff. Or a big shout out to the missions committee that really helped get all of the information and some of the video content and photos and everything that we used in today's videos. If you're interested in being a part of that and the planning that's involved when it comes to missions and maybe even planning things in the future, speak with David Melillo and obviously the other individual ministry leaders that we also talked about today. You can always get information about that stuff in the e-bulletin. But I want to ask Steve to give us our benediction in just a second, but let's give him one more round of applause and thank him for joining us today.
Thank you.
And after he gives our benediction, obviously you guys are free to go today.
I'd like to leave you with this thought that the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Ephesus. It's in Ephesians 2, starting first verse 4, "But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God. Not a result of work, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Go in peace. Amen.